So, hi everyone. It's great being here. So I've been introduced, so I think I will just start talking about women in politics. So let me start this talk with a very simple observation, which Natalia made already, which is that there is a persistent underrepresentation of women in political decision making. And over time, there has been progress, but this has been both slow and scattered. There are several ways in which we can show that women are underrepresented in policy-making decisions. One way of looking at it is to look at data from the Gender Gap Report, edited yearly by the World Economic Forum. So the World Economic Forum measures an index of gender equality for about 119 countries every year. And this index is made of 4 sub-indexes. And basically, the way to read these indexes is they represent how far we are into closing gender gaps between women and men overall, but then also along these 4 dimensions. And every year, systematically, this is for 2018, but this happened every year since this publication started being edited, you see that the political empowerment sub-index is where we have the biggest gap to close yet. Only 22% of the gaps between men and women in political empowerment have been closed to this day. Where does this number come from? What is this gap about? So first of all, another thing is to show what has been happening over time. This is not a new phenomenon, as I said. From 2006, this gender gap has decreased, but very slowly, so we're very far from catching up with the other 4, with the other 3 sub-indexes. And why do we observe this very bad performance in terms of political participation? So let's look at a few numbers. The share of women in lower house parliaments in Europe, it was about 22% in 1999. We move forward 10 years, it's 24%. In 2019, it's 32%. So to this day, about 1 out of 3 parliament members in Europe is a woman. Similar situation when we look at women in municipal councils, so in local politics. Women are about 31% of the councillors in 2011, 33% in 2019. So the underrepresentation is large, but it gets larger and larger as the seniority of the position increases, which is what has been called the leaky pipeline. So there is this idea that women are underrepresented at the bottom of political organizations, but the more we move up to top positions, and the more women we lose, so the more underrepresented they are. And we can see this by looking, for instance, at the number of countries that had a woman as a head of government in 1999. So here I really felt sorry for Europe. I had to take a world view because otherwise we would have a gray map, not fun. And you see, we have only 3 countries with a woman at the head of the government. 2019, the map gets a bit of color, not much. And even 20 years later, from 1999, things have been progressing. But as I say, this progress is slow and scattered. Same thing if we look at local politics. Remember I told you that 1 out of 3 municipal councillors is a woman in 2019. If we look at the mayor, who is the head of the municipal council, in Europe were women. In 2019, the progress has been very slow, only 15%. A few other numbers. Globally, women are 24% of the parliamentarians, a slow increase from the 11% in 1995. As of January 2019, 20% of government ministers worldwide were women. So women are fewer, and also they tend to be concentrated in certain areas. So they hold typically portfolios such as social affairs, and this is followed by family, children, youth, elderly, disabled, then environment, then employment, labor, and then trade industry. So they are fewer, and also they are segregated horizontally in different areas with respect to the areas where the men occupy these positions. In EU, currently women are 30% of the ministers, and there has been a positive trend. Ursula von der Leyen will be the first woman at the head of the European Commission, which is great, good achievement, but the Commission was established with the Treaty of Rome in 1957, so it took us a while to get there. There was never a US president who was a woman, and I'm based in Sweden. I'm Italian, but Sweden is my host country, and I always like to point out that Sweden never had a female prime minister, which I find interesting because based on experience, but also on the indexes of gender equality, any index that you can think of, Sweden always top the rankings. It's one of the most gender equal countries worldwide. Yet, in the long history of Swedish democracy, we never had a female prime minister. How about the Russian Federation? It's not gonna look better. This is the Global Gender Gap Index for the Russian Federation. This is the index compiled by the World Economic Forum that I mentioned before. So overall, as I say, this index is compiled for about 120 countries. Russia ranking is 75th. And its performance varies a lot depending on the sub-index that we look at. So here, the shade in light blue shows Russia's ranking, or actually its value, for each of its the four sub-indexes, whereas the dark blue line shows the worldwide average. And as you see, Russia is doing better than the worldwide average in terms of economic empowerment, and in terms of equality in education. All of the gap, basically, in education has been closed to this day. At the same level as the rest of the world in health, where really Russia falls behind with respect to the rest of the world is in political empowerment, with an index which is lower than the worldwide index, which is still extremely low. Why that's the case? Currently, women are 16% of the lower house members in Russia and 18% of the upper house. 4 out of 31 positions in the government are held by women. There has not been a woman at the head of the Russian state in the last century. And out of 85 federal subjects in the Russian Federation, there is only one female one, which is the governor of Yuga. There has been some representation, some increased representation. There was a female governor in St. Petersburg from 2003 to 2011, and currently the speaker of the parliament is a woman. But overall, the extent to which women are underrepresented in politics in Russia is even more concerning than in several countries worldwide. So after having documented something that probably is obvious, that women are underrepresented in top political jobs, I'm going to try to answer the question of why there are so few women in politics. Not based on what I think, but based on what the data and the empirical evidence tells us. So I'm trained as an economist, and in economics we always tend to think of social outcomes as the result of the interaction between demand and supply. So we're going to speak about the presence of women in politics as the result as well of both supply and demand side factors. So first we start from the supply side. So one thesis that is advanced is that women are less willing than men to want to enter politics and climb the career ladder. So there is this idea that men will beg women to take power, but the women don't want to. Is there evidence for that? From US survey data, we do see that women who share the same personal characteristics and professional credentials as men, and who work in professions that typically feed the political elite, report lower ambition to occupy executive offices. And why that's the case? Why are women less ambitious, if this is how we want to call it? So women appear to be less, report to be less likely than men to be encouraged to run for office. And also, they tend to view themselves as less qualified to do so. And the same authors of this study that looks at women's political ambition also try to look at the deeper causes of this lack of self-confidence or lack of encouragement. And what they find based on survey data is that this difference in self-confidence is explained by differences in parental encouragement, politicized educational and peer experiences, different extent to which women and men participate in competitive activities, and this sense of self-confidence that women tend to have less than men. A few more candidate explanations for women's lack of ambition, sort of, which is, as I will argue, not really about ambition. Women have some traits, behavioral traits, that tend to be different than men. For instance, from lab experiments, they appear to be less willing to enter into a competition. When they're asked whether they want to enter into a tournament or get into a piece rate compensation scheme, women tend to, in laboratories, shy away from tournaments, whereas men like entering this competition. On average, they tend to like to do so. Importantly, the context matters for observing these gender differences. Precy and Staubard, they do a very nice experiment in which they ask women and men whether they're interested in taking up political jobs. And they experiment with different messages given to women and men that emphasize different characteristics of the job. And they show that only when the competitiveness of politics is emphasized, women report to be less interested in taking the job with respect to men. If other aspects of the jobs are emphasized, you don't see so much of a gender difference. Then another potential factor that keeps women away from climbing the career ladder is the fact that women appear to be more constrained by family and relational consideration. And in this sense, there is a very interesting study recently published by Ulle, Folke and Johanna Rikne. They're both based in Stockholm as well, and they look at Swedish data. So again, remember Sweden, this country that tops the ranking of gender equality. They show that in Sweden, when a woman or when women are promoted to the position of mayor, they are significantly more likely to experience a divorce with respect to men who go through the same career pattern. So this type of impact on your personal life from trying to get into an ambitious job, of course, could explain why women don't want to participate to this competition, more than probably ambition, differences in ambition. So a few more reflection points on these supply side factors. First of all, so we say that attitudes of women toward political jobs matter, but one thing that it's important to keep in mind is that we have very little evidence that these differences in attitudes come from biology. Most of the times, these attitudes are shaped by the environment we are exposed to. And I've studied this question in a research work with Michelle Serafinelli from University of Essex, so I will open a parenthesis and I'll tell you a bit more about this work, which looks at attitudes toward work, not toward politics, and then I'll tell you how I think this work also informs us in understanding why we have fewer women in politics than men. So in this paper, in this research work, we exploit the fact that a number of countries in Eastern Europe and Central Asia, after World War II, were exogenously exposed to state socialist regimes. So here I report a page which is an extract from a book from Churchill's The Second World War, where he basically shares this piece of paper that he was exchanging with Stalin when the Allied forces were discussing how to split Europe in areas of influence. And I mean, it's hard to read. This is handwritten by either Churchill or Stalin. Basically, the report here, it says Romania, so Russia 19%, the United States or the Allied forces 10%. And Churchill reports that basically they will pass to each other this piece of paper, and then they will check if they agree with this division. Why is this interesting for us? Because this created, this divided Europe in two areas of influence, and then the people living in Eastern Europe were exposed to state socialist regimes without deciding, without voting for them. So we can think of this as an experiment of exposing people to different politico-economic regimes, regardless of what are their underlying attitudes toward these regimes. And in particular, there is a country where this differential exposure was particularly striking, which was Germany, that was divided between East and West. So these are two parts of the country that had a common history, common heritage, and at some point they were exposed to different regimes. And why does this matter for what we're talking about now, which are gender inequalities? The state socialist regimes put a lot of focus and a lot of effort into trying to get women to join the labor force for instrumental reasons, because they needed to increase their overall labor force participation. And they did so through different means. Propaganda, this is an example of a propaganda poster in East Germany, but also by proposing, by providing subsidized childcare and maternity leaves. The result of this focus on women's inclusion in the labor market was a dramatic increase in female labor force participation in Eastern Europe after World War II. Here, what I'm showing, think of this, I know it's hard, is the map of Germany. So this is West Germany, this is East Germany, and this is the East-West border. And what we show is that even very close to the border, so in areas that have a common history, in 1990, if you just cross the border and you go to East Germany, women are significantly more likely to participate to the labor force as compared to women on the other side of the border in West Germany. I think we are all right. Whereas we did, no. I didn't do anything, I think. Okay. Whereas there is no evidence of differences, maybe I will try with this. There is no evidence of differences for men. And why is this interesting for us? Because then We go and look into survey data. So in 1990, right after the fall of the Berlin Wall, the German socio-economic panel administered a survey to East and West Germans measuring their attitudes. And one question that they asked was whether you think that being successful at work is important for your sense of self-fulfillment and personal satisfaction. And what we find is that as we cross the East-West border, women are significantly more likely, so in East Germany, to report that being successful at work is important for them. So they put more importance on career and being successful at job. And why is this important for us? Because basically this shows us that attitudes toward success are not something necessarily that we are born with and cannot be changed, but by the means of being exposed to a different regime, these attitudes can change. And another example comes from looking at other data in 1996, where East and West Germans, again, are asked a number of questions on gender role attitudes. For instance, I know you cannot read well, but I'll read some of these questions for you. They are asked whether they agree with the statement that a working mom can have a warm relationship with her children. And these are the average answers, the average level of agreement in West Germany. This is the average level of agreement in East Germany. So you see that East Germans have less traditional gender role attitudes. They're less likely to think that if a woman works, her kids will suffer. And this is confirmed in these other questions that we're going to look at. So overall, this tells us that the attitudes that women have toward work, in this case, likely toward politics as well, can be different, but it doesn't mean it's not an excuse not to do anything. They can be very much shaped by the context where these women grow up. And the same can be said about the behavioral traits. Remember I told you that in experiments, women appear to be less likely to want to join a competition as compared to men. This is not true everywhere. Nizzi, Leonard and Liss in 2005 ran a very influential study where they basically do the same experiment in two societies, one in Tanzania, which is considered one of the most patriarchal societies to this day, and one in India, which is matrilineal. So societies where the underlying gender norms are very different. What they find is that women tend to shy away from competition only in the patriarchal society in Tanzania. In the matrilineal society in India, women love competing as much as men. So again, it doesn't seem that this is really about biology, but it seems to have a lot to do with the type of environment that these women are nurtured in. Another thing to keep in mind whenever someone tries to emphasize the supply side channel, meaning that women don't want to be in politics, is that it's very difficult to disentangle supply and demand side factors. Meaning that women's unwillingness to run in politics and to climb up the career ladder might be the result of the demand side forces, of the fact that they observe discrimination from voters or parties, and in anticipation of this, they don't want to run. So this is something to keep in mind. And finally, so the evidence tells us a lot about the average women. So on average, women appear to have less ambition to be in politics than men. But one thing we need to keep in mind is that maybe what matters here is not the average, but it's the tail of the distribution. Meaning, on average, maybe women are less ambitious, but probably there are some women, a handful of them, who want to occupy some leadership positions, and we should be able to find those. But now, this naturally transitions us to the demand-side factors. So, women seem to be less willing to run. There is some evidence for that. But what happens on the other hand, on the other side of the market? What do the voters and parties think, and what role do they play in promoting women to top positions? And I'm going to start looking at survey data that try to understand whether voters are biased against female politicians. So I'm going to look to show you here now some data from the World Value Survey that ask, among several attitudinal questions, this question that is particularly interesting for us, which is whether the individual respondents agree or disagree with the following statement, that men make better political leaders than women do. And the respondents can answer that they agree, strongly agree with this statement, disagree or strongly disagree, or they can say that they don't know or don't want to answer. And these questions are asked to a representative sample of people in different countries. Here I report values, so the level of agreement in a number of countries in Europe or in the former Soviet Union or in some of the biggest world democracies. And what you see is that the level of agreement with this statement that men are better political leaders than women is quite low in countries such as, for instance, the Netherlands, it's about 11%, Sweden, 11%, a bit larger in the United States, 19%, in Germany, 20%. But then it becomes much larger as we consider countries in the former Soviet Union, including Russia, where the level of agreement with this question is above 50%. So more than 50% of survey respondents in the Russian Federation from this representative sample think that women, men make better political leaders than women do. So then probably whether voters' bias explain women's underrepresentation in politics very much depends on the country that we're going to look at. So probably does play a role in countries such as, for instance, Azerbaijan, Turkey, Uzbekistan. In the world in general, we're very close to 50% of respondents who think that men are better than women in politics. Regarding what happens in European countries such as Sweden, the Netherlands, Germany, or the United States, we can't tell whether voters are biased because, and I think it's interesting, I'll get back to the other slides later, the World Value Survey does not ask the opposite question, which I think is also tells us something. So 11% of the Swedes, of people in Sweden, think that men make better political leaders than women do. And one could then think that there is some bias against women in politics in Sweden, but no, because maybe 30% of people in Sweden think that women make better political leaders than men do, but we do not know because the World Value Survey does not ask this question. So maybe we should contact them and ask them to start doing it. But I'm not allowed... It's not. Okay. Just one last thing about this question, another thing that I want to show you, which caught my attention. So here I considered a number of countries. I selected them because these are the countries that we can observe over time through three different ways of the World Value Survey, so between 1995 and 2014. And here again, I report the share of individuals, of respondents, who agree with the statement that men are better political leaders than women do. And you see that in many countries, this share has been decreasing over time. In some countries like Germany, it increased a bit, but from low levels, from 15% to 20%. The only country where we start from a high level and there is no sign of decreasing trend is the Russian Federation. If anything, the level of agreement with the statement has been increasing in the last 20 years. So, then, as I said, based on the survey data, we think that the extent to which voters are biased against women very much depends on the country that we are looking at. What does the economics literature tell us? What does research tell us about this? There is not much evidence of voter bias overall. For instance, in some work that I did with Manuel Bagues from University of Warwick, we study gender quotas in politics, and I'll get back to the result of this study several times through this talk. One thing that we find is that the parties that are forced by the quota to increase their share of female candidates did not experience a dramatic change in their electoral performance, which tell us that voters are not particularly upset from seeing more women in the electoral list. Otherwise, they could have just moved away from these parties. So then, voters don't seem to play a big role, in at least in some contexts, such as Spain, for instance, in explaining why there are no women at the top of political positions. Then what's the role instead of parties? Parties are intermediaries between voters and politicians. What's their role? Do they discriminate against women? We have some evidence that parties do discriminate against women, for instance, coming from Spain again. This is from a 2012 work from Berta Esteve-Volart and Manuel Bagues. They show that in electoral ballots, women are systematically placed in less favorable positions, meaning that they are at the bottom of the electoral ballots. And we do know that the names that are on top of the ballots are those that get more votes. So those names on top of the ballot will be male names. And it's very interesting the way parties do this, because actually, in Spain, the names of the candidates on the electoral ballots are listed in alphabetical order. So then you will wonder, how can they stack women at the bottom of the ballot? Guess what they do? If you have a last name like me, Campa, maybe you will not be on the ballot. So they go and look for women whose last name starts with letters that are farther down in the alphabet. Very interesting. And then you'll think, do they do this because they themselves don't want to have women, or maybe that's the voters? They know that the voters will not vote for women if they were at the top of the ballot. It doesn't seem to be something that has to do with voters, because when the elections are particularly competitive, then you do find the women on top of the ballot. Meaning that when parties need to attract more votes and to be competitive, to display their best candidates, they do choose women. But when they have a safe seat, when they're sure that they're going to win, then they're going to have the men at the top of the ballot. So this suggests that the discrimination seems to, at least in this context, be more on the vote on the party side than on the voter side. And also, we look at the number of votes that women get as compared to men, and there is no evidence that women attract fewer votes than men in Spain. Yet they seem to be discriminated by the party. In the paper on gender quotas also that Manuel Bagues and I wrote, we look at the application of gender quotas in local politics. And basically, these quotas prescribe that parties need to list at least 40% of women in the ballot and every 5 positions, because they want to prevent parties from stacking women at the bottom of the ballot. What we show is that the most likely pattern in the list is, guess what? You have men, 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 woman, woman. Then men, 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 woman, woman. So you need to have at least 40% of women every 5 positions. You find those women most likely at the bottom of those 5 positions. So then, overall, based on this literature in economics, it seems that, in part, women's low propensity to run for political position, and in part party bias account for women's underrepresentation in top political positions. We don't know much about voters' bias because, as I said, in countries where voters do appear to have some negative attitudes toward women in politics, we don't have many studies telling us how they vote when women are participating to the elections. One thing to keep that is important to keep in mind, again, is that I talked about demand and supply factors, but it's very hard to separate those two, because again, when we say that women are less willing to run into politics, if they anticipate that they're going to be stuck at the bottom of a ballot, maybe that's also why they don't want to participate in politics. But now, the next question that I'll try to answer is, whether this matters, why are we talking about this? Is it important to have more women in politics? And I'm going to borrow from Marianne Bertrand, who speaks about women in corporations, and lists three reasons for which we might be worried about women's underrepresentation in politics. One is, I call these arguments the equality argument, the efficiency / quality argument, and the representativeness argument. So the first one, the equality argument, is based, I think I'm missing a slide here, anyway, is based on the idea that gender equality is a human right. And that therefore, just simply like that, we should aspire to have equal representation of women in different labor markets, included the market for politicians. So this is a powerful argument if we think that, in part, women's underrepresentation in politics is due to discrimination. And as we saw, we have some evidence for that. But economists tend to prefer another argument, actually, which is called the efficiency argument. And this is the idea that if we choose our leadership, our political leaders, from a bigger pool, it's more likely that we are going to get more talented people. What is the idea here? So there is an underlying assumption that talent is equally distributed by gender. And this goes back to what I said before. Maybe on average, women are less inclined to be political leaders, but there must be some women who are good political leaders. These are top jobs. We don't need a huge amount of them. So say that women are as likely as men to be political leaders. I'm going to help myself in this reasoning by using some animation in case you start being bored, so I'll bring some color in the presentation. So say that we have in this pool blue balls, pink balls, I use stereotypical colors, just not to be confused. And these are average people who can be good politicians, but on average, or like average ones. And then we have the golden balls that are the most talented people, those who really will be great political leaders for our countries. And say that from this pool, we need to draw our political leaders. So, in principle, what we will want to do is just to select the golden balls. But if we are not only maximizing talent, but also we are restricting our selection to have more men than women, then at some point we might exhaust the talented men and we'll start drawing from the average men. So we would have something like this. But then what happens if instead we remove this restriction? So we're going to replace the average men with the talented women, because we still have something to draw on from that pool that we were discriminating against. So overall, we would have a better selection of our political leaders. This is a theoretical argument. And I can show it also with the less colorful figure.
say again that this is the distribution of talent in the population. We have people who are very bad politicians, people who are average politicians, and people who are really good. And say that we are only taking men, so we're only extracting our politicians from the distribution of men. So we say we take only the best men, and we draw the line here, and this is going to be our talented politicians. But if we have two distributions, one for men and one for women, and we get politicians from both, then we can move our line to the right, and we get fewer men from here and the number of women, then overall we have a more talented pool of politicians. Now, what is the evidence for this theoretical argument? In order to look at what happens if we have more women in politics, several studies have looked at what happens when we introduce gender quotas. So some countries, especially in Europe, but also in Latin America, for a number of years now, have been using gender quotas to elect women to their, more women to their political institutions. What happens once you bring more women in politics? What happens to the quality of politicians? Is it the case, as some people might be concerned, that you are sacrificing policy, sorry, quality, due to the quota? It doesn't seem to be the case based on evidence from Italy, for instance, where we have been using quotas in local elections, and a number of papers, and the most recently published one comes from a 2014 study in the Journal of Public Economics, they show that women are more are elected to these political positions, are more educated than men. And so the average education of elected politicians increases once quotas are introduced. Same evidence from Sweden. So in Sweden, one party, the Social Democrats, use an internal quota voluntary. And a number of authors from Sweden have studied this quota. And they basically find that when the quota is introduced, what happens is that the less talented men resign from the position of politicians to make space to more talented women, so that overall the average quality again of the elected politicians in Sweden due to this quota increased. And here the quality is measured based on some labor market performance. And interestingly, this is something that is shown in a study, but the authors of this study also talked to some politicians, and they have been told that in the party internally, they were talking about this quota as the crisis of the mediocre man. Because anecdotally, they were seeing that the men who were displaced by the new women brought up in politics through the quota were the worst politicians to that point. We also study the use of these quotas in Spain, and the quota that we study in Spain are adopted in small municipalities. So there you could have more of a concern because these are areas where women might be less educated, also the gender ratios are more unbalanced, they're more rural areas. Still, even in this context, we find that quality does not increase, but it does not decrease either. So overall, this concern that if you have a quota, you sacrifice the selection of politicians, you just don't select the best politicians yet, is not confirmed theoretically and in the data. So to the best of my knowledge, there are a number of studies from Western democracy. None of them shows that the quotas decrease the quality of the elected politicians. Of course, one thing to keep in mind, one caveat of these studies is that it's not obvious what is quality. We have been measured it as education, labor market performance, but maybe there are other things that voters care about and that we are not able to measure. So we need to keep this in mind. So now the third argument for which we should want more women in politics is the so-called representativeness argument. And I need to represent it with this picture. So the representativeness argument is the question of whether a male-dominated political body can make decisions that represent women's preferences. And this is a picture that struck me because here the President of the United States is signing a decree about abortion rights. And these are the people who surrounded him when he was making this important decision. So the question is a bit about, do we think that this group here knows much more about abortion rights than women? Do we think that the female perspective here in this particular context would have helped? What do we know? The evidence in this sense from the data, answering the question whether basically women make different political decisions than men, is mixed depending again on the context, and actually more work needs to be done. So for sure, women, this is something for which there is no ambiguity, do appear to have different preferences over policies than men. And one can look at this in different ways. In work that I've done on Spain with Manuel Bagues, for instance, we look at survey data, where in Spain, women and men are asked to list the things that are most concerning for them and that they think that the policy should address. And we find not too big, but significant differences between the concerns that women and men report. In particular, women appear to be more concerned by unemployment, pensions, the status of the health system, drugs, youth problem, violence against women, women's problems in general, and social issues. Whereas men appear to be more concerned about housing, immigration, work conditions, politics, corruption, infrastructure, the environment, the judiciary system, and agriculture, hunting, and fishing. So they have different concerns, as expressed in survey data. We also see that women and men are different when we look at how they reported to have voted in a referenda. And one study, which is the most rich in this respect, comes from Switzerland. Not surprisingly, this is a very fertile ground where to study behavior in referenda, because in Switzerland, referenda are run pretty often. And basically, based on the reported voting behavior in Switzerland, women show less support for increasing the retirement age, nuclear energy, and the military, and more support instead for environmental protection, healthy lifestyle, equal rights and assistance, equal rights for women, and assistance to disabled. Finally, another way to see whether women and men are different in terms of political preferences is to look at what happened when women were given the right to vote. And a paper from Lotte and Kenny studies how the government changed, the policy changed in the United States as the different states at different times gave women the right to vote. And they find that with the women's suffrage, there was an immediate increase in state government expenditures, and also federal representatives started voting in a more liberal way. So overall, the consensus in the literature is that, on average, women tend to prefer bigger governments than men and to be more liberal on a number of issues. So then, does this matter for policy making? Women seem to have different policy preferences than men, but do they make different decisions once they get to actually be political leaders? There are two types of studies that look at this question. One uses, again, gender quotas that get more women elected, and then we go and see what these women do. Another one looks at elections where women win by a narrow margin against men to compare environments that are largely similar, but where, for a flip of a coin, a woman happens to be elected. And what do we learn from these studies? The evidence is mixed, but as I said, in part this comes from the fact that more research should be done on, in particular, Western democracies. We have a lot of evidence from India. India has been experimenting with a lot of quotas in the last 20 years at every level of government. And Chattopadhyay and Esther Duflo, who is the recent Nobel Prize winner, the second woman to win the Nobel Prize in economics this year, studies, for instance, the seat reservation in India. So in India, at some point, it was decided that one third of the villages had to elect a female leader, a female pradhan, a female head of the village. And this means that in this one third of villages, only women could run for this position. And the villages that were to implement this policy at every election were selected randomly. So then we can compare, this is a good experiment, we can compare policies made by women and policies made by men. And what the authors find in this very influential paper is that women tend to put more money on areas where female voters are more likely to bring complaints, which in India happen to be drinking water infrastructure, for instance. So you find in India that women bring up their concern about drinking water infrastructure more often to the local politicians. And when these local politicians are women, they spend more money into this infrastructure. So in this sense, having women in these positions matters in terms of representation, with the female preferences being represented more. Irma Klotz-Figueras also has been studying the presence of women in political positions in India at the state level, and she finds that when there are more women elected to a state, there are different policies being made, and I'll tell you more about what are these policies. But also she finds that there is an intersection with the caste. So it's not only gender that defines us, there are other characteristics. And all these characteristics that we bring in our political experience as individuals matter for the type of policies that we choose to promote. So for instance, again, Klotz-Figueras, one thing that she finds consistent also with the difference in preferences between women and men is that when more women are elected at state level in their districts, there is a higher access to education. Or also, in a follow-up paper in 2014, Klotz-Figueras and Sonia Balotra find again that these women elected the state legislator tend to spend more in maternal and infant health. So in districts that elect more women, you have more public health facilities, an increase in antenatal care visits, more institutional delivery, and more breastfeeding. Finally, this I find very interesting, still in India, another paper shows that when women are elected to the state legislature, there is a significant rise in crimes, in documented crimes against women. And this might sound puzzling, but what the authors managed to find successful is that there is an increase in reporting of crime. So if there is a female politician, so women are more likely to come forward and report violence against them, which is consistent with other evidence that also the number of women in the police and municipality level matters for women's willingness to report violent crimes against themselves. Other evidence comes from Brazil. And so Fernanda Broglio and Ugo Troiano show, interestingly also, that when a woman is elected, it's less likely that there are corruption scandals in Brazil. Also, women are less likely to engage in political patronage, meaning that in this particular case, they are less likely to hire temporary workers in the government, And they're also less likely to be re-elected, which the authors show could be due to the fact that women are less likely to engage in political patronage. So the evidence from Brazil and India tell us that it makes a difference if we have a woman or a man at the head of a hierarchical organization. The evidence from Western democracies actually doesn't tell us the same story. Ferrara and Giurco look at elected female mayors in the US and they don't find that they make systematically different decisions than men. And also in my study of gender quotas in Spain, we look at budgetary expenditures at the composition of the public municipal budget when there are more women, and we don't find that women put money in different areas than men. So, overall, there is rich evidence that the gender of policymakers matters from India. Surprisingly little evidence from Western democracies. We don't know much yet to be able to say whether women make different decisions than men. Another thing that is important to keep in mind is that it can be hard to measure some differences. For instance, right now in Italy, a group of politicians from the majority coalition made a proposal that is called the tampon tax. Basically, in Italy, we tax sanitary products, tampons, as luxury goods, 25% of VAT, the same as tobacco and alcohol. And the coalition of women in the parliament now passed a proposal, or actually brought forward a proposal, to reduce this tax to 7% as the other necessity goods. This is something that we couldn't capture in the data. If I look at budget expenditures in Italy, I'm not going to be able to see this. Still, having had this coalition of women from two parties bringing this proposal in the Italian parliament might have made the difference in this sense. So then, we can somehow say that we are concerned that women are underrepresented in politics. It's an issue in terms of equality, in terms of efficiency, and in terms of representativeness. So then the next question is what to do if we want to do something. From what we said so far, there are a number of policies that we can consider. First of all, one idea is to start acting on the supply side. So we know that women tend to shy away from the competition, but this is also, we know from lab evidence that that's more likely to be the case if certain features of political jobs are emphasized versus others. So if we emphasize politics as a competitive masculine arena, then women probably are not going to want to participate in politics. If we emphasize other types of characteristics of the political jobs, the possibility to make change, for instance, maybe we might be able to attract more women. How we do that is not obvious, but for instance, in several democracies in Europe, you have a school of politics where students participate to training programs to become good politicians. And the message that is given through these schools in terms of what politics is about, what it means to hold a political job and to be a political leader, it's going to be important based on what we know about the fact that women don't like to be in a competitive environment, but we don't need to emphasize that particular aspect of political jobs. Regarding the importance of family and relational considerations, the fear that you're going to get a divorce if you're promoted to a better job, Ulle Folk and Johanna Rickne in their paper suggest that in that area probably reforms should come from other labor markets. In general, there should be a promotion of more gender equal roles, and this could be through, for instance, paternity leaves, childcare, the promotion of role models. But as we said, there is an important actor in this environment, which are parties who seem to play a role in holding women back from advancing to top positions in politics. So while acting on the supply side, probably one good thing will be also to try to stimulate what we call the demand. And how do we do this? This is the elephant in the room, quota or not quota. So is this something that we should hope for? And I'm going to show you that a number of countries in Europe have decided to try with quotas. So this is a map of EU28 countries that have used either so-called legislated quotas, meaning that these are introduced by law, or voluntary quotas that are introduced by the parties. And these quotas are different than the Indian seat reservation. They are candidate quotas. So they only prescribe that electoral list should include a minimum percentage of women and a maximum percentage as well. For instance, in Spain, each of the two sexes need to be represented for at least 40%. So which means that you cannot have more than 60% of women. What do we know about these quotas that have been used in European countries and in Latin America as well? First thing that is important is that they do tend to increase women's representation in legislative institutions as long as they're well designed. Remember the example that I made about Spain? There is this rank order condition. You need to have 40% of women every 5 positions, and then the women are at the bottom of each of these 5 positions, which means that then the number of women who are elected is going to be less. So you have an increase in the share of women who are candidates, but then the increase in the share of female councillors is going to be lower because the seats are assigned based on the position on the ballot. So one thing that has been shown to work well is the so-called zipper quota used in Sweden, for instance, or in France, where you prescribe that women and men are strictly alternated on the list. So that if the seats that the party wins are allocated based on the order in the list, every other position you have a woman and every other position you have a man, so it's less likely that you have this attrition between the women who run for elected positions and those who are actually elected. So the quotas do increase the share of women who are elected, but I started this talk emphasizing also that there is a leaky pipeline, that we keep missing women as the seniority of the position increases. And ideally, if we really want to aspire for quality, we will want quality at every position. Then, do the quotas, the candidate quotas, improve women's access to leadership positions? There is not much evidence, or the evidence, let's say, is mixed. It seems to have been the case in Sweden, but not in Spain, for instance. And it seems to have been the case in India and Italy as well. In general, it should matter, given recent laboratory evidence on what we call gender group dynamics. So in experiments, women are assigned to different teams, some that have a male majority and some that have a female majority. And it is shown that in male majority teams, and only in male majority teams, women are less likely to lead the discussion, to influence the decision that the team makes, to put forward their name to lead the team, and to be voted leaders. So then if we increase the number of women in parties, and at the bottom of the positions, given this gender group dynamics, it is likely that we could expect women to have an easier access to the leadership positions. Of course, I'm telling you what I know about quotas in certain contexts where voters do not seem to have a bias against women. Quotas might work differently in a context where voters are biased against women in politics, So you always need to keep in mind their role, because voters might amplify the effect of quotas, but may actually also reduce it if they vote less for parties that increase, due to the quota, more their share of women. Policy change, as I said already before, it's hard to measure. So we don't know from in Western democracies whether quotas change policies. We know that they did so in India. Also, it's not obvious what should be the size of the mandated increase in representation. So I told you that in Spain, the quota did not cause policy change. But due to this placement of women in the worst position in the ballot, the quota increased the number of women elected only marginally. So the increase was only of one woman every other council. So half a woman more, basically, in each municipal council. So maybe it's not that women don't make a difference, but they need to be a bit more than half a woman to make a difference. We do not know. And importantly, I think this is something probably comes from my own personal experience. Whenever I have a discussion about quota, one of the main concerns that I hear is that, you like quota, but then you want to sacrifice quality. We're not going to choose the best politicians. And there is literally no evidence across several studies that quotas decrease the quality of the elected politicians. So then my answer to the question quota or not quotas is why not? But first of all, it's important to understand what is the most efficient design given the context. Are we going to go through marginal increases or we rather want a big push? Is it enough to have one more woman in a legislator or there is a risk of tokenism? These are questions that require more research. For those of you who want to do this type of research, these are questions that are still open there to be answered. Also, candidate quotas are unlikely to change substantial representation, meaning we have more women in politics, but it has been hard to see more women in really influential positions where the most important decisions are made. So probably, quotas can be used, but they cannot be an excuse not to do anything else. They should be combined on other policies that act on the supply side on the market, on women's willingness to be there, and on the role of parties that appear to hold women back. And aside from quotas, we need to think of other factors that from recent evidence, this is the most recent research, appear to be important. We know from laboratory evidence that women react more negatively to backlash. This evidence comes from firms when female managers receive complaints from the workers, they tend to react more negatively to this. And recent evidence also shows that on social media, the language of the political discourse has been becoming more and more aggressive. So one question that now researchers are trying to answer is, what does this do to women? Since they do not appear to want to opt in for jobs that are particularly competitive, particularly tough sort of, what happens on the social media where the language is particularly tough? Another important thing is that can be done regardless of what is the final objective, if we want or what not want to increase the presence of women in politics, is to monitor developments, to collect data, to try to know more about A, where there are more or less women, and B, what do women do once they occupy this political position. And in this sense, technology can help. For instance, a recent development is to use machine learning to read text, computers basically, to read text from political meetings. So we don't know much about what happens in political meetings. Many of the meetings are recorded though, and this is most of the times written text that no researcher has spent time to read systematically. The machines now can help us to do this, to understand more about what women and men do differently or in the same way once they are in these political institutions. Another important thing that I'm going to emphasize is that we should not become easily satisfied with positive development because there is evidence that progress is not linear. The fact that the share of women in parliamentary institutions has been increasing at a certain rate over time, that does not mean that they will keep increasing, it will keep increasing at the same rate. In the US, labor force participation, for instance, has been increasing dramatically from the 70s to the 90s, and then it has stalled, and the quality was never reached. So positive developments are good, but let's not assume that they're going to continue in the same way in the next years. So, these are the concluding pictures, which tell us that there has been positive development, but a lot of work is still ahead of us. So these are pictures for some recent international meetings, and you can observe the share of women in these meetings, or here. Interestingly, I think most of the times you can spot the women from the color of their dresses. So this is gonna help us. Here again, you can spot the woman. And I'll conclude here. Thank you very much. So now we're going to take questions, but if you have more questions, thank you. Yeah.
Good evening. Let me wait until you put on the headphones. My name is Nuria Fadihova. I work in the German magazine, and I'm the author of the project She's an Expert. My question regards the quotas. I know that there are two countries where the quotas are set not by the parties but by the parliaments, and they are prescribed in the constitution, Rwanda and Kenya. Rwanda, that went through the genocide 30 years ago, now 50% of the parliament representation is women. And already now we can see the results of this, because Rwanda, in just a few years, changed the conditions, and the opposition is formed of women, and very interesting processes of democratization are underway. What do you think? Should we expect the same future, in particular in Europe? Maybe we should introduce similar quotas in the Western democracies, and we'll see the gender equality world.
Okay. Thank you very much for your question. I haven't mentioned Rwanda because my sample selection was somehow biased in a certain part of the world, but Rwanda, interestingly, is one of the most gender equal countries according to the World Economic Forum, the Gender Gap Index. So, a couple of thoughts about that. I think Rwanda is a very interesting experience. Of course, what we think of women's representation in parliament is a bit different as compared to in a context like such as Rwanda, where the quality of the democratic institution is not as high as in other European countries. There is always this very important underlying question, that is what leads a male-dominated parliament to pass gender quotas? And in a context where, given the quality of the democratic institutions, probably women cannot challenge ultimately the leadership, maybe it's easier to see the quotas being promoted versus a context where more women in the parliament will give them higher chances to challenge the leadership. But this said, Rwanda has 50% of representation of women, which is higher than in many other countries, but in European countries, a few parliaments have reached this level of representations through the mean of gender quotas. And one of these is the Spanish parliament that used gender quotas in local politics, as I studied, but also in national politics. And then the result is that you have a 35% share of women in parliament. So I think, as I said, my argument to the question whether more European countries should use the quotas is really why not. So we still have to see more research about the benefits of quota, but for sure, I don't think that there is any research that show that they are detrimental for the quality of our democracies. So then, even if our only objective is quality, if we are not going to worry about representativeness and efficiency, then probably, yes, quotas will be welcome because I don't see evidence that they come at a big cost for the selection of political leaders and for the quality of the democratic system.
Good afternoon. My name is Irina Tolmachova, and my question is related to psychology. In Russia, the people say that in big politics and in business, there are no men, neither men nor women. Mostly, this is said by men, and they want to point out that feminine tricks do not affect us, and we're going to fight women in business and politics in the same tough way as we fight men. Do you agree with the idea that there is no men nor women in politics, and men try to protect themselves from women's influence?
So thank you very much for your question. I think this your question speaks to the representativeness argument that I talked about. And as we were seeing from the data, for sure there are women and men when it comes to policy preferences. Women do seem to have different priorities than men. Then the question is whether this translates into them being different politicians. And this depends on a lot of factors, including the way in which a legislator makes decisions. So theoretically, we can expect anything. The empirical evidence is that mostly in developing or emerging countries, having women in at the top of hierarchical organization does matter, does makes a difference in terms of policy decisions. Whereas we don't have a lot of evidence yet from Western democracies. And I think the question is really that the context matters a lot. First of all, one thing that matters is where these women are. Remember that in Europe, the quota only increase the share of women in the parliaments, in the legislators, not in the executive positions. So we don't see an impact from these women in politics, but this doesn't mean that these women are not different than the men, necessarily, it might be. What it might mean, on the other hand, is that the women do not have still substantial influence on the policies, since they do not hold the executive position. So I think my answer to your question is we need to know more, but based on what we know from developing countries, it makes a difference to have the women in these positions. And from developed countries, we don't know enough because we haven't observed more women in executive positions in a systematic way, in a way that could be studied. And hopefully there will be more study coming up soon. There is one recent study from Germany that looks precisely at what I mentioned before, what women talk about in the municipal councils. And one thing that they show in these studies is that women tend to bring up more often issues related to childcare services in the political meetings. And I haven't mentioned this study because I only chose to talk about papers that are published. This is work in progress. But the direction that is suggesting is that potentially, for instance, in mothers who have more women or not in a council, because in terms of what type of childcare services are offered in this jurisdiction.
Good afternoon. My name is Galina Sharikina. I work in education. Please tell us, Pamela, were there any research that allow to show the correlation between the representation of women in state policies in the states where the feminist movement is stronger? And are there any evidence and research that allow to see the correlation from the point of view of representation of men of women in politics, where the one gender marriages are allowed? And maybe this could help us understand why women are represented less in politics.
Yeah, thank you. So in terms, I think I can break down your question in two. One is about the correlation between women presence in politics and the strength of the feminist movement. And I'm not aware of systematic studies about this, but one thing that one example, I think, does not come from research, anecdotal evidence that always inform research, comes from Sweden. So as I said, in Sweden, the Social Democrats, the Socialist Party, has adopted this internal quota that prescribes this zipper quota, the strict alternation of women and men in electoral lists. And Sweden now has 40% of women in municipal councils and 50% of women in ministerial positions, although, as I said, yet we didn't have, to this day, we haven't had a female prime minister. So how did the socialists get to this quota? Why did they pass it? So women, the feminist movement in the Social Democratic Party in Sweden formed a coalition where they basically threatened the party leadership. They told them, either you introduce quotas or we're going to form a separate party which is going to take votes away from you, because we do have followers who are in favor of our feminist policies. And given that the Social Democratic Party, under the threat that the women in the party will form a separate party, thus splitting the electorate, which this is a proportional system, so most likely will cause them to lose the election, under the threat, they introduced the gender quota. So I'm not aware of systematic correlation, but this is an example of how the feminist movement got some political change in an effective manner. And regarding your question about the evidence of women in politics and policies that approve or in favor of same-sex marriages, it's a very interesting question, and I'm not aware whether this has been studied. Not that I know, which doesn't mean that there is not, maybe I'm missing something, but it's something definitely that it could be worth looking at.
Pamela, thank you for your lecture. We can see a lot of women today, and I'm sure some of them would love to represent it in politics. So what should they do? What would your advice? Thank you.
Okay, so I'm not a politician. I've had a very short career in politics. I resigned. So maybe not a good example, but I think a lot of how to motivate my students to pursue careers that are potentially very ambitious. And one thing definitely that I noticed in the approach that women and men, female and male students, I've been teaching in Canada at the University of Calgary in Sweden, so that's my experience, is that the women do tend to have less self-confidence than men. And it's not only my personal perception, we know this. And in particular, I have had several conversations with students who tell me, I will want an academic job, but I'm not going to apply for it because I'm sure I won't get it. And then my answer is always, and now you're applying for it, because we don't care whether you get it. We're never going to find out, and the cost of trying is not so high, so just try. So I think there is a bit more of this self-doubt, which I can also relate to, and it comes from the survey data as well, where the women have less confidence, they feel less encouraged by parents, by their peers. And I think the only way of getting around that is to try nevertheless, even where when you're self-doubting yourself. And that's definitely my advice in terms of any type of career, that you don't decide before you even try whether you're good or not for something. You go out, you test, and if this doesn't work, it's not the end of the world. There are plenty of other careers that you can try to pursue.
My name is Tatiana Sukhareva, a Russian feminist. You mentioned the feminist party. Is there any example of feminist parties, and why this initiative is regarded as a threat, a negative trigger? This is my first question. And second question is the following. You said that women have less propensity for discussions and for domination in discussions, leadership in discussions. Do you think maybe this is related to the propaganda of traditional gender roles, where a man is the fighter, the invader, and a woman is a household host and the wife? And maybe the culture should be changed and education should be changed so that self-assured women number is equal to the number of men.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much for your question. So regardless of the experiences of feminist parties, as I said, I think, one interesting experience comes from Sweden. And as you asked why that is perceived as a threat, I mean it in a positive sense, as a threat especially for the left-wing parties, because there tends to be a left-leaning, so women, feminist women, tend to be more likely to be voters of the parties on the left side of the political spectrum. So if these women threaten to form a separate party, this is going to most likely take away votes from the left-wing party. And that's the sense in which I mean that they are a threat, because basically the left-wing party has to decide whether to keep these women and get the votes from their constituents or to let them go. And probably they're going to do it a different extent depending on what is the cost of keeping them. In Sweden, the party judged that introducing a gender quota was not a big cost And the benefit from this was that they kept these women in their party, and with them they kept their voters. So I think finding a party which is particularly likely to be voted by people who have concern about feminism, and threatening that party of forming a separate party that would attract those votes from the feminist could be an effective way to get the party to do different choices. And you asked me another question. Yes.
Remember, я повторю тогда.
No, I remember the question. It came to me now. Thank you very much. This is a huge question in terms of, so the way we formulate it is whether it's nature or nurture. So two things that I want to emphasize. One is the evidence that I mentioned that women are less likely to participate to the discussion, to put their name forward, to be leader, to contribute to the decision making of the team, only applies to male dominated groups. So when women in these experiments are with the female majority, then there are not huge differences in the way, in the likelihood that women and men participate to the discussion. And the evidence in this sense is pretty rich from experiments, which I think tells us that this is not about biology, because biology most likely doesn't change depending on who we have around. But also, if we think of these attitudes toward competitiveness, as I said, they tend to change depending on the societies that we look at. If you look at the matrilineal society, where women are nurtured to think that they're equal or maybe even more influential than men, then they do not shy away from competition. So the idea that the images that we are exposed to and the gender roles that we are exposed to matter is very much, finds very much, is confirmed in the evidence from the data. And third, also, speaking to your third point, whether we should change education, I do think that that's a direction in which we want to go, because also there is evidence that these attitudes can change depending on what type of models we're exposed to. As I said, we show that in a period in socialist countries where women were massively participating to the labor market, the gender role attitudes changed substantially. These countries became less traditional. Evidence from, for instance, soap operas, interestingly, in Brazil, show that when women in Brazilian villages, rural areas, are exposed to soap opera, they're more likely to divorce. And I'm not saying that divorcing is a good thing, don't get me wrong, but just they observe women divorcing from their partner in particular situation in the soap opera, and then after having been exposed to these different models, they're more likely to make different decisions. Again, I don't want to say that this is good or bad, I do not know, but what I want to say is that models and exposure to these models and to examples definitely can change the way we perceive ourselves and the way we perceive what are our possibilities and the possible roads that we can take.
Well, first of all, thank you for interesting and insightful lecture. I wanted to ask you about how do you think the far-right movement and Donald Trump and Brexit and all the things that come to mind have affected gender equality policy and the whole idea in the long term, mid term, short term? Thank you.
This is a difficult question, because I think it's a very recent phenomenon. But let me tell you two things. So one thing is actually an observation made not by an economist, and it's not based on data, but this is made by a sociologist who points out that when there is a political regime or a political party, such as the recent right-wing parties emerging in the United States, Italy, the UK, Germany, Sweden, etc., that emphasize a division in society between based on ethnic lines, most likely all the other differences are going to be sacrificed. Because in the name of these divisions, we do not see the differences between classes, between gender. So the division between, in the political discourse of Trump, for instance, or of the political right in general in Europe, there is a lot of emphasis on how we are different from migrants. And then this emphasis comes at the cost that we do not discuss how women and men are treated differently, how blue collars and white collars are treated differently, and so on and so forth. But last week I had a Skype call with a PhD student at the London School of Economics who wanted to ask me some questions about a project that she's starting. And spoiler, I don't have an answer. This is a research project. But she starts from observational, from anecdotal evidence. She notices that some extreme right-wing parties in Germany or in Italy, they tend to promote women to some political positions. And her hypothesis is that they do so to normalize their positions in the political arena. So in order not to appear as too right-wing, as too extreme, they can increase their share of women so that certain type of voters feel less worried about these parties because the women soften out a bit the image that they're giving, which can be scaring. And she looks at this in some a couple of elections in Germany, where she finds that there are more candidates from the right-wing parties that, than from the left-wing parties, and that when these parties have more women, they attract more votes from other women. So this could be a political strategy. So it's not obvious, because also we should think, we should distinguish between substantial representation from descriptive representations. So some parties can have a large share of women, but the women don't get to influence the type of policies that are made. And then we should be careful at concluding that these parties are furthering the gender equality agenda.
So thank you very much for your lecture. And I got very interested that you mentioned there is a difference between the developing economies and developed countries regarding the gender equality. First of all, regarding the political decisions taken by women when they take power. There's the effect of catching up development phenomenon. It means that it is easier to achieve higher growth rates for the developing countries because they manage to use the tools of the developed countries. So my question is, maybe there is the same dependence so that the gender politics or the politics aimed at the gender equality, so that the efficiency is going to decrease, and then the women politicians will be taking more or less the same decisions like in the developed countries. Thank you.
So I'm not sure I will answer your question right. So I think what you're asking is whether I think that in developed countries now there can be an increase in women's participation to political process in the same extent in which this was done in the developing countries, and whether I think that this will cause policy change in developed countries as well. And so there are I have to say I'm a bit skeptical about it, because one thing, for instance, as I say, that happened in India, which seems to have made a difference, is that they had this seat reservation. meaning that the Indian Parliament said the most important seat in local in village level politics and is going to be occupied by women in 1/3 of the villages in the country. And this has produced policy change because you don't increase the share of women in any position. You increase the share of women in the most influential position. Is this going to happen in our in Western democracies, for instance, or more developed countries anytime soon? I don't see the political economy of that. I think I see this as a very difficult political process, again, that a male-dominated parliament agrees to promote, to reserve a number of seats to women, because this means that 1/3 of the male politicians will need to make the space for the most influential position. And I don't think that that is going to, or at least let's put it this way, I haven't seen this type of political discourse in any country to this point. Another thing that I want to emphasize, and this goes back to my answer regarding the question of Rwanda, it's very different what a quota means in a mature democracy versus a country where the democratic process is not extremely developed. So in a developed democracy, giving women 50% of the control or giving 50% of the seats of the parliaments means probably that women really will be able to challenge the political leadership all the way to the top, which cannot happen in Rwanda given the way the political process works. So the cost of having a large quota in Rwanda for the incumbent politicians, for the male leaders, is lower than the cost in, for instance, Italy or Spain. So I find it a bit difficult that we're going to have these big push policies anytime soon.
Hi, thank you very much for such an interesting lecture. I would like to know, are there any differences in political behavior? I mean, I'm interested in cultural differences, and could you please suggest any of published research about women political behavior and participation? Thank you.
So there are a number of studies that come to my mind. I think in terms of really behavior, probably the most interesting among the published papers is the paper that I mentioned from Brazil. So Fernanda Brollo and Ugo Troiano look at what happens in Brazil when a woman is elected by a narrow margin against a man. So this is, as I was saying, a flip of a coin. By chance, a woman is elected. What is going to happen in this municipality? How does the woman behave? And what we know is that she's less likely to engage in corrupted activities. So the episodes of corruption reported are lower. And importantly, she's less likely to engage in political patronage, which means that she's going to be less likely to use, basically, policies and funds in order to attract votes and to secure her future election. Which on one hand is a good news. On the other hand, the result is that these women are less likely to be re-elected because political patronage does seem to have a bearing. This is from academic published work. I've seen recently policy reports, so this is not peer-reviewed, but they're pure analysis. They look at the behavior of women on social media, and they find, of female politicians in social media, and they show through text analysis that women use a different language and they engaged in less aggressive confrontation. This is not a published study, but if you email me or you talk to me later, I'm happy to give you the more specific references for these studies. Yes.
Thank you very much. I'm lucky to make this question. I'm Anna Fedorova and I'm a political technologist. I am a political technologist, and I've got a question about the quotas. I am a supporter of quotas, and I think that this will improve the quality of representative power in Russia, because for the moment we have only 22% of women in our legislative structures, but we have the double structure in our legislative parliaments. The problem is that we have two types of voting for the representative quarters and for the political quarters. And this allows quite a lot of space for different manipulations, not allow women into the legislative institutions. And this gives the opportunities to the parties not to allow women to participate. So maybe the correct decision should be not to introduce these preferences, not on the level of processes like giving quotas, but to provide quotas already from the point of the seats in the parliament. But then maybe this would contradict to the will of the voters. I myself is part of confused, so maybe you could comment on this.
No, so let me tell you two things. When I was talking about the impact of quotas, so first of all, I think it's important to have the right design, in the sense that if you want to increase women's representation, you have to make sure that you are constraining the parties as much as you can. The example from Spain that I brought up, so they thought, let's give them some room of maneuver. So they need to have at least 40% of women every fifth position. So softer than the zip quota used in France or in Sweden. And what happens is that the parties exploit this room of maneuver. So they stack the women at the last two positions. So if you really want, my point is, if you really want to do it, then you go all the way and you really constrain them in the extent to which they can discriminate against women. But then you say that you're confused in terms of, if we do something particularly strong, maybe we're contradicting the opinion of the voters. And then it will be really important to understand in a country, for instance, such as Russia, why voters think that women, that men make better political leaders than women do. If this is due to discrimination, then you still will want to have the quotas. And I give you an example from India. This is another paper from the Nobel Prize winner Esther Duflo and co-authors. So they look at the long-term impact of the quotas on voters' perception of female politicians. And what they find is that in the long term, after a couple of rounds of applications of the quotas, voters review their opinion of women in politics in a positive way. So they're more likely, when they have been exposed to the quotas, to believe that women are better political leaders. And this could be because what the voters are doing is just to, what we say in economics, statistically discriminate against women. There is nothing about the taste. It's not that I do not like women, just I don't know enough, so I'm not gonna trust them doing this job. I have plenty of observations from men. I know some men can be better, some men can be bad, but at least I know how they behave. If I don't know much about women, then maybe I don't want to experiment because, and also another cost of having few women is that then I'm going to assume a lot from a few observations. So it's enough to have one woman who is not a good politician, and then the voters will think that women are not good politicians. So as they experience more, women in politics as they get to observe them more, if they're just statistically discriminated against them, then they'll change their opinion of the women. And there is evidence from Sweden and also from Italy. In Italy, we had the quotas, then we removed them, but still, women in the municipalities at the quota kept being elected at higher rates. We removed them after they work, exactly, but then they keep working. So in those municipalities where we had the women, because this was only for 2 years and different municipalities have elections of different types, then there was a persistent long-term increase in the share of women in politics, which tells us maybe once we introduce quotas, we are somehow contradicting the will of voters. But if the voters don't want to have women in politics just because they don't know enough about it, then quotas are a way for them to learn and potentially update their beliefs as they appear to have done in India or in Italy.
Большое спасибо. Я могу сказать, что у нас очень благодарные слушатели. И с моей точки зрения очень интересная лекция и очень интересные вопросы. И было очень сложно выбрать лучший вопрос, а мы обещали, что у нас лучший вопрос получит приз. И когда все очень много очень хороших вопросов, сложно выбрать, тогда выбираешь по некоторому признаку, который тебе ближе к сердцу. И вот я выбрала вопрос, касающийся Brexit, неудивительно, потому что я занимаюсь в том числе глобальными вопросами глобализации, поэтому такой вопрос, который и вопрос интересен, и тем более, что он дает пищу для новых размышлений и новых исследований, к чему всех людей, кто к этому имеет отношение, призываю. Раз вы не представились, спасибо большое. Вот. И приходите к нам на следующие. А, девушка, представьте, пожалуйста, как вас зовут.
Да, добрый день. Меня зовут Мария Гусельникова. Я закончила University of Portsmouth, экономика и менеджмент. Вот, и уже второй раз прихожу на ваши лекции. Очень интересно, спасибо. Thank you.
Большое спасибо всем, и мы ждем вас на следующих лекциях этого цикла и последующих, и кому это интересно, на днях открытых дверей. Большое спасибо.